here we are sitting at not Engaged Studios, but at Pastor Anthony's house.
Yep.
How's it feel?
Feels good. I love this house.
We've been eating Cheez-Its.
Yeah.
Lots and lots of Cheez-Its.
Yeah.
What's the Cheez-Its competitor? Cheez-Ums? No.
No.
Here's like another cheese.
Goldfish, I think.
No, not Goldfish. Goldfish is good. But there's Cheez-Its and there's another brand. Cheez-Ums.
I'm just laughing because you poured this whole bowl so we could eat it while we were watching today's thing. And we have eaten through half of it and we still haven't watched the video yet.
That's the effect of Cheez-Its. Yeah. If you're out there and you are a huge Cheez-Its fans, not Cheez-Ums, because there's, if you don't know the difference, there is a difference. And if you don't know the difference, I literally cannot trust you. Cheez-Its is where it's at. Okay, let's get down to it. Today, we're going to be doing something we've never done before. This is a fan request review. They want us to watch a Bono and Eugene Peterson review. Now, Eugene Peterson helped write a translation of the Bible called The Message, which is it's very popular. It's something that a lot of people can relate to. Some people don't like it. They have problems with it. But it takes the biblical language and stays faithful, but makes it in a very relatable manner. And so this is going to be Bono and Eugene Peterson meeting for the first time and discussing the message and the Psalms. And so what you're about to see, we're going to break up in two or three segments. But again, we pay attention to what you want. So I hope if you like what you see, hit that subscribe button and you'll make us very happy. You'll help get the you help get that our message out there. So this is something you're not going to see anywhere else in any other podcast. This is unique to hear. So this is Pastor Anthony and Seth and Pastor Anthony's fingernail that's been bashed by dumbbell welcoming you to Bono and Eugene Peterson and our review. Let's do it.
Let's do it. People are going to think because we're listening to all this U2 that you painted your nails black.
All right. Have you watched this?
No.
Can they hear us right now?
Yeah.
Can they hear me eating Cheetos?
Yes, they can.
Mr. Peterson, Eugene, my name is Bono. I'm the singer with the group U2 and wanted to sort of video message you my thanks and our thanks in the band for this remarkable work you've done. There's been some great translations, some very literary translations, but no translation that I've read that speaks to me in my own language. So I want to thank you for that. Take a rest now, won't you? Bye.
I never heard of Bono before. And then one of my students showed up in class with a copy of the Rolling Stones. Rolling Stones? And in it, there was an interview with Bono in which he talked about me and the message. And he used some, you know, slangy language about who I was. And I said, who's Bono? And they were dumbfounded. I'd never heard of Bono. But that's not the circle that I really travel in very much. So that's how I first heard about him. And then people started bringing me his music, and I listened to his music, and I thought, I like this guy. And I was starting to, after a while, I started was being quite pleased that he knew me.
Yes, but the rest of the story is when he invited you to come and
hang with them for a while, you turned them down.
I was pushing a deadline on the message. I was finishing up the Old Testament at the time, and I really couldn't do it.
You may be the only person alive who would turn down the opportunity just to make a deadline. I mean, come on. It's Bono, for crying out loud.
Dean, it was Isaiah.
Yeah.
The Old Testament is a long, long book, much longer than the New Testament. And it did take a long time and a lot of devotion on both of our parts to have that happen.
I have to say, in the last years, Eugene's writing has kept me as sane as this is. If you call it sane, which you probably won't. Run with the Horses. That's a powerful manual for me. And it includes a lot of incendiary ideas. You know, I hadn't really thought of Jeremiah as a performance artist. Why do we need art? Why do we need the lyric poetry of the Psalms? Why do we need art? Because the only way we can approach God is, if we're honest, through metaphor, through symbol. So art becomes essential, not decorative. I learned about the prophets. I learned about Jeremiah with that book, and that really changed me.
Real quick. That line, the arts are essential, not, what did he say? It was essential, not.
He said the art is the only way to learn about God. It's us being honest with God.
Right. Which, thank God someone said it. That's awesome. But I'm trying to think what he said. The art is essential, not a something.
Wait, are people hearing this right now?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's right before.
Lyric poetry of the Psalms. Why do we know? Because the only way we can approach God is, if we're honest, through metaphor, through symbol.
Wait, that's...
So art becomes essential, not decorative.
Not decorative.
Not decorative.
It's essential, not decorative. Wow,
wait,
that is good.
Why are you saying that?
Because thinking about my own upbringing, being in the church, the arts are always seen as, like, I would have said up until now, the arts, from the view of the church, is decorative, not essential, right? We think of a sermon, a Bible study, as being the essential part. But having the arts put into that through music, through writing, that's the essential, because that's how, which I'm just showing through how, what they're talking about so far, that's exactly what the Bible gets across. The Bible itself is part of the art, is it not? Through writing, through expressing, through poetry, right? I never heard that before, mm-hmm. up until this very moment.
Mm-hmm. I think when I was cutting the grass, when I was listening to this in preparation, and again, for those of you that are listening to our channel, Seth listens to things cold, which I really like, and I like to listen to things ahead of time so I can let them marinate. But this is one of the points that I remember sticking out to me. There's 150 Psalms in the Bible. It's the largest section of the Bible.
Yeah.
All of them are poetry. All of them are David being honest with God. And I had to think to myself after hearing this, it's like, if you know anything about David in today's world, and probably in any day's world, David would be considered a screw up. No one that's close to God because of the things that he's done. Mm-hmm. Yet the Bible paints a picture that David is very close to God, and people throughout all generations adore David.
Yeah.
Why is that? Because David is a poet.
Yeah.
David is not narrative. David is not 1 + 1 = 2. David is being broken and vulnerable to say things that other people may think but don't say.
Right.
You know, they're talking about taking vengeance on their enemies. They're talking about being depressed and swimming in their tears in their bed. They're talking about joyous victories of God, but it's all very expressive language because he's a poet.
But
and he connects with people, I think, on the deepest level. And isn't that cool? And we're seeing someone who's similar to that, another poet, Bono, that connects that way.
But like the thing that I just realized now, it's not even just the Psalms. You make a great point, but think about the book of Genesis. Genesis is a mixture of both historical, but there's also poetry in it. I'm thinking of the, you know, Genesis chapter 2. There's plenty of places throughout the first four books of the Bible which rely heavily on poetry. All throughout, a lot of the minor prophets are written in poetic terms. It's a popular way of writing. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why they chose to write that way. I don't know why. I never heard of it that way up until now.
Mm-hmm.
But so, I'm loving this. I'm on cloud 9. Want anything else?
No.
Okay. Thank you guys for recommending this, because this is awesome.
And then several years later, this was about 4 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, Bono would like us to come to Dallas, to my Jan and me, to come to Dallas and for a concert. We went to the concert. He was very sensitive to us. We were really well cared for, had really good seats. And I'd never seen a mash pit before. That was my introduction to the mash pit. Is it a pit?
It's a mosh pit.
Mosh pit. Okay. You can see how uneducated I am in this world. And we had it was a 3-hour lunch. And we just had a lovely conversation. It was just very personal, relational. He didn't put me on any kind of a pedestal, and I didn't him, so we were very natural with each other. But I was just, through that 3-hour conversation, I was just really taken by the simplicity of his life, of who he was, who he is, and there was no pretension to him. And so I, at that point, I just, you know, felt like he was a companion in the faith.
Just for you YouTube fans out there, not only have I become a fan of that song 40, I'm not kidding you, I've listened to it probably at least once a day since we did that video.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I can't get it out of my head. It's such a nice... My favorite time to listen to that song is right before bed. Turn the TV off, put my phone in the other room.
And then I text you.
And then, yeah. And then I'll go onto my laptop. I just type in Spotify. And I listen to a playlist that I have of calming music. And then I just sit for at least for an hour and just think about my day. And this song is one of the songs on that playlist. And I, just through the Spotify, I don't know, system, the song seems to always play, like, it's like the fourth or fifth song that gets played on that playlist. And it's just such a perfect way to end the day.
There you go.
So thank you guys so much for you know, recommending not only the song, but this documentary. We're 5 minutes in. I know you're probably getting irritated that I keep stopping it, but
no.
There's so much to unpack here, so much to talk about. This is fantastic, and I can't believe that Eugene Peterson never heard of Bono.
Well, here's the other thing that's cool, is we started this together where we had no idea where this was going to go, and our goal is to minister to others. But in a weird way, all the people commenting are actually ministering to us in a weird way.
That's what I was just going to say, yeah.
Man, this is really cool. So let's see where this goes. We're 5 minutes in.
I think it's one of his best ones. And he sings a lot. I mean, he does this a lot. It's one of the psalms that reaches into the hurt and disappointment and difficulty of being a human being. And acknowledges that in a language that is immediately recognizable. You know, there's something that reaches into the heart of a person and the stuff we all feel. Many of us don't talk about.
I waited and waited and waited for God. At last, he looked, finally he listened, and he lifted me out of the ditch. He pulled me from deep mud. He stood me up on a solid rock to make sure that I wouldn't slip. He taught me how to sing the latest God song.
All right, so that ends it for part one. So far, I am loving this. This is just through part one we've watched. This is extremely well put together. I'm liking where this is headed. This is also flying by. I can't believe it's been 7 minutes since we started this. This is fantastic.
This is part one. Stay tuned for part two.